at the very least within the priest classes of ancient Egypt and within the mystery schools of today, such as Freemasonry, especially within the higher degrees, other dimensions are accessed. They were in ancient times for sure, and they are today, and that is for sure. From a chalkboard that was at the entryway to an exhibition at the Sydney Masonic Centre, we can read. Welcome. In the world of sacred symbols, they come from other dimensions. Always visible in the worldly life, since the farthest times. They represent the universal code to read reality beyond the appearance. The magic key to unlock the mystery of existence and the bridge of light to reach who you really are. Please note the top part among the whole thing, but so in the world of sacred symbols, they come from other dimensions, always visible in the worldly life. Okay. I'll now read from Furze Morrish's book, The Ritual of Higher Magic. So, reading from page 72 to start out with. In ancient Egypt and in the forgotten civilizations of Atlantis, from which Egypt derived its occult knowledge, there were two classes of hierophants, both priests and priestesses. The one a royal priesthood of light, and the other a dark priesthood of both sexes. The symbol of the priest or priestess was the serpent, the uraeus, symbolizing the psychic tube which clairvoyance studies in the brow chakram. The priests of light wore this symbol on the headdress, in the proper position protruding between the eyes, as shown in old pictures of the pharaohs of Egypt. The priests of darkness in Egypt wore the uraeus on the belt, protruding from the solar plexus and indicating the negative methods of awakening occult forces. I will now read from page 78 and 79, and there is mention of ancient Egypt in here, and it's part of the theme of this video. So, reading Dark Rituals and Their Outcome. One of the perverted functions of dark rituals since the Lumerian root race passed away was to release the primitive desire elemental from its increasing control by the human ego. The animal soul, liberated from the physical body by ritual and endued with a semi-conscious life of its own, derived from elementals and crude nature spirits attracted by the ritual, was by this means allowed to free play, to roam loose and indulge its savagery unchecked. These rituals were a throwback to Lumerian rites designed, as it has been pointed out, to individualize primitive man through the awakening of a sexual technique. They were relics and combinations of the torture rituals of Lumeria and the rhythmic dancing of primitive man through the awakening of a sexual technique. They were relics, legends, but horrid facts. By means known to some occultists, the etheric double is released from the physical body and is able to roam at large, free from ordinary physical restraint. The white occultist uses this means of serving mankind, but the black magician for preying on humanity. This loosening of the etheric double, now recognized among many spiritualistic mediums, was originally brought about by the performance of rhythmic rites. The latter, having stimulated the astral body and awakened the animal nature, proceeded to entrance the physical body, which collapsed and allowed the animal soul to escape. A similar process, under proper supervision, was carried out in the mystery temples of Egypt, by which disciples were drawn from the body and initiated into the secrets of nature. These mystery rites took place also in Greece and along the Mediterranean, but were debased in some instances, such as the orgies of Bacchus, which evoked the powers of the kingdom of Pan, symbolized as the half-goat, half-human, and indicating the beast in the astral form of man. He who gazed upon the face of Pan became maddened, filled with panic, i.e. panikos. I'll just jump ahead a little bit now and read from page 80 and into 81. As usual, these dark rituals had to be performed at certain phases of the moon, especially just below new moon and just after full moon. They appear to have been attended by numbers of people from surrounding districts in search of secret gratification of lusts not recognized even by those brutal times. At some of these ceremonies, accounts reveal that entities, normally invisible, took horrible shape out of the etheric physical forces drawn from the bodies of those present, forces which would probably be known as ectoplasm today. In fact, force which the spiritualistic medium throws off and thus enables visiting spirits to materialize. There are historical accounts which prove these orgies, and as they agree in substance with clairvoyant accounts of similar rites which were carried out in ancient times, there seems to be some connection between the two. I'd just like to make a bit of commentary regarding the depictions of what some people consider are light bulbs in Dendera in Egypt. In fact, some people try to even recreate light bulbs. If we look at the depictions, we can see the lotus flower or lily flower at the base, you could say, with the serpent or snake emanating out and this sort of area around the serpent kind of emanating out, it seems. If we look at the Lotus Temple in Yeogerville in Virginia, they have the lotus centered in the center of the room at the base on the altar, and a light beam comes out and sort of heads up to the top of the room. And I would suggest that this is where the snake or the serpent, the psychic tubes, run up and down also along this space, along this beam, if you will. Now, the lotus is depicted in Centennial Park in Sydney, near what people commonly refer to as the Centennial Park Cafe. And it's in the center of what I would suggest is the greater ritual space with the concentric circles coming out. And there are other features there. And there are also sort of a serpent-like railings around there also. And there is another place in Sydney near the gates of the Botanical Gardens just off Macquarie Street where you have what appears to be the lotus also. And there are other depictions of the lotus as well. And I would suggest that the snakes, the psychic tubes, emanate from the lotus. So if we look at the depictions in Egypt, we can also see that the heads of the people under this area that is around the snake, they sort of connect with that area. Whether there is a little round shape there, or whether the head simply just connects with it, and the people under there perhaps seem to be praying, sort of as well, some sort of kneeling fashion. There's also a differentiation, it seems, between the scale of the participants there, but beyond that, there are also sort of other sort of connections going from the head to the to that sort of shape around that light bulbish shape around the snake, which I would suggest is a some sort of potent area of magic, if you will. An area of enhanced psychic potency, a psychic field, if you will. As far as those emanations from the head go, They perhaps refer, and I'll just refer to Furs Morrish's book, where we have a diagram and we can see these emanations coming from the human head and throat in this case. So just reading here, it will be noticed in the diagram, figure I, that there is a center of magnetism radiating up from the top of the head. This same phenomenon is observed on a greater scale as far as the Earth is concerned, in the name Northern Lights or Aurora Borealis. A similar principle seems to be operating. Also, you can see hands connecting with that psychic space. And as Furs Morrish tells us in his book, The Ritual of High Magic, the hands are always emanating out etheric magnetism. So I think this is what is being depicted here, and it clearly is an area where a magic ritual of sorts is being carried out, in my opinion. So look what we have here, and please study it. What do we have? Now, just to set the scene here, and this is what happens when you research stuff. Look, earlier on, I was trying to describe a serpent coming out of the lotus, and here we have that lotus at the base with the serpent sort of going straight up as it looks in this case, which I think is fantastic. And I've only just come across this image, and this was whilst I was trying to find images for the last piece of audio that you've listened to. So I didn't know when I was laying down that audio that this image existed or exists. So here we have it. We have this serpent coming out of the lotus here. And notice we don't have the field around it. It's sort of there naked, if you will, a psychic tube, if you will. So where's the light bulb here? There isn't one. But what we are getting still is this these descriptors for the lotus, for the nerve centers, the chakras, and we have the psychic tube coming out here in the snake. If you put this stuff together like I do, I just find it fascinating when images just pop up that just sew it together. But now, just before I just conclude this video, if we look at the serpents, and then I think if we look at these Egyptian characters riding the serpent, and we can see stars there, I think we can see that we have depictions here of astral travel, if you will, sort of riding these serpents through space, and I would suggest through time as well. But I'll leave it at that for now, and I hope you've enjoyed the presentation.